This in John 15, 1, he says this, I am the true vine. What that means is there must be other vines that aren't true, right? There's other ways, but I'm the true, I'm the real one, I'm the true vine. And my Father, he's letting you know, he's the gardener. I mean, he's really trying to get the message to us here. And here's what he's basically saying. If you want to know my Heavenly Father, what's important to him, what he values, the way he looks at things, look at how a gardener looks at things. That's what he's saying. Now, here's the problem with that, is that we don't operate like that. That doesn't come natural to us. If I ask some of you, like, hey, man, we got to plant a garden and live off that thing as a church. Some of you are like, I don't know what to do, right? And I get you, but that's going to change. So anyway, we got to grasp this, and Jesus is going to unpack this through that lens. And so we got to be willing to look at it a little differently today. So here's the way what we're talking about today is, and you may not realize this or not, but God often works through seasons. We got to get that concept down of season. It's how he cultivates our faith is through seasons, all right? So here's the thing. We know natural seasons. We learned that in kindergarten maybe even before that. Summer, fall, winter, and spring, that was pounded into us, and we know what that means. But there are also spiritual seasons. And I believe God gave us that natural way to learn it so that we could learn the spiritual meaning as well when we were able to comprehend it. And I don't think many of us understand that God actually cultivates our faith through spiritual seasons. So I want to help you unpack that, and I want you to be able to recognize today, one of my goals is to recognize what season you're actually in, because we're all different. Just because we're together in church doesn't mean we're all in the same season. Spiritually. And I want you to be able to identify today what season that you're in. And I got a couple of spiritual truths about that I want to give you. You'll probably have a lot more when you go back and look at your notes and you read the scripture that we do for yourself. There's something different about it. It plants it even deeper in your heart. When you do that, these are things I pulled, okay? And so the first one is this. Here's the first truth that I unpacked, is that life unfolds in seasons. We got to understand that. We got to understand that in our walk, in our following of Jesus, that life unfolds and actually in season. He decided that a long time ago, God did, that he was going to unfold your life in the framework of seasons. And so this is what he says in Genesis 8 and 22. As long as the world exists, there will be a time for planting, but also a different time and a time for harvest. There will be cold and heat. There will always be summer and winter, and there will always be day and night. Now you say, well, Richard, why did God choose to unfold my life in seasons? Yeah, I don't know. I have no idea. But when you're God, you get to make executive decisions like that, and that's what he just decided to do. It's the way he chose to do it. But what I want you to get from this truth is that it does unfold in seasons. There's something to it. But here's what that means. That means if things are going really good for you right now, you're like, man, I couldn't ask for it to be better. Seasons change. You know what I'm saying? If things are going really bad for you, you're like, man, this is a really tough time in my life. Listen, seasons change. So we got to get used to that, because life unfolds in season. Now here's the second one I've got, you know, kind of a spiritual truth. You got to get this if the rest of the message is going to make sense. Is that every season has a purpose. Every season has a purpose. As a matter of fact, in Ecclesiastes 3:1, it says, to everything. Everybody say everything. Everything, there's a season and a time to every purpose under the heavens. Okay? Now, we prefer certain seasons, don't we? There's certain ones that we like better. Like in a natural sense, some of y'all, not dummies, don't say dummies, Richard, like this extreme 98 degree heat. You know what I'm saying? Well, you should be more like me. Fall, spring, a little bit more mild. You know what I'm saying? We prefer certain seasons over other ones, but every season has a purpose, is what Scripture says, all right? So as a matter of fact, what I've learned is, man, it's often the season that you don't like the most is sometimes the season you learn the most in, right? And so God's got a purpose for every season in your life, and we've got to understand that as followers. And like right now, some of you, man, you're like, man, I work for a horrible boss, Richard. I wish I could describe just how bad it is. Some of y'all are in that season. If that's the season you're in, man, God's trying to grow your character in that season. There's something going on there. There's a purpose for it. You know, some of you all are starting college and going back to school in the fall. Man, I've got 19 hours, credit hours this semester. It's going to be rough. Well, listen, in that season, God's trying to teach you discipline. All right? There's things that no season is worthless, okay? Some of you are like, man, things are really going good. I got a promotion at work, right? Big sugar daddy now, or sugar mama. We'll see, in that kind of season, God wants you to learn how to celebrate him, okay? Celebrate his blessings. And if some of y'all, you just had some babies, we got a lot of babies around here, and honey, God's trying to, he's going to be teaching you something, right? It's because every season has a purpose. Now, here's the third one real quick, and you got to know it, is every season requires a specific action. Just because that season, there's something about, there's an action that needs to happen within that season, because farmers don't have an off season. There's no such thing. Because if it's winter, they're preparing, okay? They're preparing in the wintertime. In the fall, they're harvesting. They're busy with that. And in the spring, they're planting. And in the summer, they're cultivating. Okay, so there's not an off season. They don't have one. And here's the thing. Every season they know, a farmer would know, requires a specific action in that season. Okay, because they understand, man, if they show up to plant a seed and there's snow on the ground, they're not going to have any success. Okay, so it has to match up. As a matter of fact, all of the success in farming really comes down to this is matching the season with the right action. That's going to make a lot of sense in a minute. And all of it comes down to knowing what season it is. And that's what I want for you today, is to understand there are seasons. They're not always the same season. I can't control the seasons. But there's something in whatever season I'm in, once I identify it, that I know what to do when I'm in that particular season. And that's really what I want to help you with, okay? So, because I see people all the time, they're frustrated with where they are in life. They thought that thing would have already happened. They thought God would have already come through in that season. They're in a period of waiting, and they think that maybe, man, is he playing hide and seek with me? What is that? And I can assure you that God is not interested in hiding his plan from you, okay? And so I see people, man, they're in a winter season, man, and they're trying to plant in a winter season. And it's just, it doesn't match the season that they're in, right? They want to reap, and they want to harvest, but they don't want to put the work in. So today I want to help you discern that, and I think it's huge, and the good news is it's available to you. God can really start to pour into you, and you actually receive what he's pouring. And so that's what we're doing. And the problem with so many people that are frustrated, just don't understand the season that they're in. Maybe you're in a relationship. It's been broken a long time. I mean, it's really broken. And you're struggling. And you're having a hard time figuring out. But you don't know what to do because you don't know what season you're in or what to do in that season. I feel like I'm beating a dead horse with that. But I want to show you this in 1 Chronicles. It's a whole list. If you go back and read, it's a bunch of peoples living in Israel, okay, and just where they are and kind of what they're doing. And it only says this one. It's just a little piece in the Old Testament that's just tucked away. But when I read across, I thought, this is so lame. I can't keep up. And, you know, what's this actually saying? But this is what it says. You probably never read it before. 1 Chronicles 12:32 says, the sons of Issachar. So the Bible's just making this long list of all the people who live in Israel. But what it notes here is what they were really good at and what kind of gifting they had from God is what it's showing us. And it says that they had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do. Okay? Because they had a lot of enemies, people coming against them. And when you go back and read it, all of those things. And what's awesome about these sons of Issachar is they know what season they're in, and they knew what to do in that season. Okay? And so I want that for us. Anybody connected to this church or anybody that's, you know, here's my voice, is that, man, we can do that successfully. It can take some of the frustration when we understand these dynamics. But it said, you know, you can know the season you're in and what to do in it. So, as a matter of fact, that's what I want to do the rest of the message. And I want to help you with I've been doing questions for a while now, months. Just something for you to ponder now and then think about again today or later this week when it comes back up, when you do your personal study. Here's the two questions. Got them on the same slide for you. First one's this is, what's my current season? Now that we're talking about it, what season am I in? And while I'm at it, what's my specific action in that season? So please find a way to capture that. I know you're taking pictures of me. Just lift your camera up a little bit and take one of the screen so you can get that. And you're asking God, what is my season? You don't have to figure it out. You ask God, he'll tell you. He'll let you know real quick what season you're in. All right? So we're asking God to match me up, God, with the season I'm in, because they don't match. I'm doing things that out of season. All right? You ever seen somebody wearing UGG boots in the summer? You know what I'm saying? It's like, that don't match. That's what people have this tendency to do, right? And whether you realize it or not, you can sync your season. You know, you can line it up with the season that you're in. So that first question is pretty important. You know, what's my season? And here's why it's important, because farmers don't spend any time, zero time, to change the season, because they know it can't be done. It's coming. But what they can do, they can adapt themselves to the season that they're in. They can line it up because they know they can't change the season. But we tend to try to do that as spiritually speaking. We're in a tough season. We're asking God to change it. God, I declare the next season, Lord, in my life. And we try to say that, but that does not work. That's why the farmers don't even try that. We talk like that all the time, but we finally realize that that's just impossible. That's just not going to happen. And we just have to, because it causes frustration when we're not in sync in the season we're in. I'll give you an example. My beautiful, lovely, darling bride, wife, she's always on the go. Bam, 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 bam. I got things. I'm not quite as busy, but it's still kind of busy. If we don't at some point sit down and line up our calendars, right? She just has to sit me down and talk slow like I'm in kindergarten. And she has to repeat it because I guess the look on my face tells her she needs to repeat that. I didn't get it. Now, I would almost swear that sometimes she says she told me something, but she really didn't. Any guys know what I'm talking about? Yeah, that's a trick. I think they teach that to girl school or something. But listen, if we don't, just this weekend alone, I just kept having to ask her, now tell me what your day looks like, because that impacts what my day looks like. And so we have to do that, because when we don't line it up, we're not in sync, it causes frustration, right? And the same thing is that we've got to grasp is sometimes we show up in a season that God's got you in, and we're expecting something different. And we're frustrated because of it. And it's like a farmer that shows up, like I said, with snow on the ground. And he's ready to plant seed. He's going to be frustrated, right? The expectation was wrong in that moment. And we see it in our lives all the time. You know, some people, everybody wants harvest, right? Oh, I declare this season a harvest, Lord, that we're going to have harvest. We want harvest in our jobs, harvest in our homes, harvest in our marriage. We love some harvest. But here's the thing that gets me, though, is if you went to a farmer and said, how do we get harvest in our life right now? How do you do that? Just harvest all the time. And he would say, I don't know. Because the harvest is only one quarter, one fourth of the seasons. That's what a farmer would say. Look, you only get harvest one out of four seasons. Why would you expect to it always to be harvest? We love it, we like it, and we prefer it. But harvest is only one of the seasons, right? And we've got a culture, the culture we live in just wants harvest all the time, right? They want to sleep with somebody without putting a ring on it, right? I tried to use that example, right? They want to own something without earning it, right? They want harvest without the plowing, right? And if we're not careful, that seeps into our spiritual life. Right, that somehow it's always harvest, and there's never any other season. There's never any work, and we expect harvest, and we don't get it. We start to think, well, maybe God forgot about me. Maybe something's wrong here, because I'm not where I thought I ought to be. But we just learned that harvest is only one. God's trying to teach us one part, one out of four seasons. Right. There's three other seasons, though, that God's working in. And if your expectation is always harvest, you're going to miss out what God has for you in all the other seasons. Okay? So, I'm going to show you this real quick, if you got a minute. And some of you ask yourself, you know, well, what season am I in, and what action do I need to take? Because some of you are not in a harvest season. That's not where God has you right now. Sometimes you think you ought to be because your neighbor, somebody around you, is really having a season of harvest, right? And so I want to show this to you because some of you are not in harvest. And the season you are in, when it's not harvest, is you're in a working season. Write that down. Working season. You got to work. When God wants to start something in you and give you a dream, start a ministry through you. He wants to do all that. He wants to elevate your life. He wants to bring fruit to your life. And he does. It starts with getting started. You got to start work. And like a farmer doesn't just show up in a field and then there's corn. That's never happened. What he does is he shows up and he starts. He starts by getting the rocks out of the way, right? He starts by, you know, making some rows so the corn can be planted. You know, he's got to plant the seed and all that. But in short, this season, this working season, means you got to get started. You don't just sit back with your arms folded. So if you want a better marriage, man, you better start speaking better in the marriage. Make some moves. Make that appointment for marriage counseling, right? Start doing things. Start being more selfless. Some of y'all, there's a couple people in our church today, they want to be a doctor. You better enroll. You better take the classes necessary for it. I mean, it's not just going to fall in your lap. And I don't know if you've ever noticed this about people, but they start to make spiritual excuses on why they don't start. Yeah. Why they don't start working. Things like, I'm just praying about it. I'm waiting for God's perfect timing. I'm waiting for God to open a door. I'm praying that employer calls me to ask me for my resume. You know what I'm saying? But you got to get started at some point, man. That's just not the way it works. So there's a season that maybe that's the season that you're in. And let me help you a little bit better than that. Some of you are praying for what you want, but I want to encourage you to plant and pray at the same time. Not just pray. Praying is awesome, and you should. You should start out with that. But I want you to pray while you plant, right? You need to take that resume to somebody if that's the job you want. If you need to pray while you actually go on a date, right? Usually it's not just poof, a man or a woman just pops up into your life. And you need to pray and actually go to the gym. You see what I'm saying? Y'all smell what I'm stepping in? You got to pray and plant at the same time. Because here's what's happening. It's like a farmer. You go up to a farmer and you look over his field. So, man, that's a good-looking field you got. Well, what you planting there? Well, corn. Corn. Oh, so you did plant corn? No, I'm just praying for it. You know, a farmer would never say that. There's work that has been done and needs to be done. And so anyway, what that means for some of you is this. Some of you think that you're waiting on God, right? You really think, I'm just going to wait on God, when actually he's waiting on you. You've probably heard something like that before. And he's waiting on you to get started, to actually make some movement. And I hope this will grab you, or you'll grab this, is that faith's not a feeling. Faith is actually action. Okay? I know you feel like, man, I feel like God will do this, and he can, and he will, and he wants to. And that is great to have that perspective. But I would propose to you that faith is a little more than that. When you're actually doing the work, demonstrates the faith that you have even further than what you've got going on in your mind, because it shows you're preparing for what you're hoping God will come through on, right? So faith is not just you pray and he cancels your debt. An action would be, hey, well, let me go, get some help with a budget here. It's not just, man, God's going to drop a ministry on my lap. The action is, why don't you go serve somewhere until God reveals what that ministry is going to be.
Right.
And he will. There's an action to it, right? And faith is not just your marriage will improve all of a sudden. Just pow. It's, man, you got to start speaking positively about your mate. You need to start being selfless and serving your spouse, because faith is action, right? It's not a feeling. And for some of us, we're expecting harvest. But God's saying, no, it's the season of getting started. It's the doing the work. You're not going to have it until you get started. As a matter of fact, here's what I noticed. And I try to change this. I'm going to say it the way I wrote it, and I'll come back and correct it. Is that God cannot bless what you won't start. And I think you know what I mean there. God cannot bless what you won't start. What am I blessing? Because you hadn't done anything. I'm not sure that he can't, because God can do anything. I would change that to God probably won't bless what you won't start, right? There's no ministry blessing or financial blessing. If there's no starting, there's no blessing. So for some of you, you're saying, man, what's my season and what's my specific action in that season? For some of you, it's just getting started. So some of you need to pull the trigger on some of that stuff you've been sitting on, praying about, thinking about. It's a season of getting started, and some of you haven't started yet. Now, here's the second one. Here's the second season maybe you're in. You've done the work, right? You've done a lot of work, but now in your season, where it's a watering season, okay? A watering season. I wish you'd write that down, because you don't just put something in the ground and it pops up. It's just not how it works. It's got to be watered. It's got to be. Now, some of you have been to my house in the backyard. I've got a patch of grass. And they dug it up. They installed like a pool. And then the grass is just a bunch of red clay. I thought it's going to be red clay forever. But the guy said, I'm going to plant this seed. But every day, I want you to come out here and water it. I said, no problem. He said, it'll come up. Don't worry. I said, okay. Now, I can plant a garden. The grass, I don't know. You know, never had to really worry about it. Some of y'all have lawns. I got grass. Y'all mow the lawn. I cut grass. All right? And so I just didn't want it to be red clay, is all I really didn't want it to be. So I got out there, man, the first day, and I'm watering it, man. I'm watering it, you know. Can't wait for it. It's going to be lush. I'm watering it. Man, nothing happened. No, I couldn't see any grass coming up. Second day, I'm out there doing the same thing, man. I did it on day three. I'm like, oh, my gosh. I started panicking a little bit, like, that guy probably ain't gonna answer the phone I call. I thought, and I feel stupid. And so I just kept watering, man, even though it didn't make sense for a little bit to keep watering. But man, I kept watering day after day after day. And man, it's tough to continue to pour into something and you don't feel like you're making any progress. Just like your marriage, like Richard, man, I'm serving my husband. Speaking life into my wife, and I just don't see any change. And that is difficult, man. It's hard to keep doing the right thing when nobody around you it seems like they're being affected. Some of you say, man, my kids are, I read the Bible to them, Richard, but they still act like the devil. You know, just keep pouring is what I'd like to say to that. But, you know, Richard, I started tithing. You know, God put it on me to start tithing, and I just hadn't won the lottery yet. I feel like something's wrong. You know, I just keep doing it. But listen, you're in a pouring phase. Okay, some of you may be in a ministry. It doesn't maybe seem to be growing, or something that you know God's called you to or called you to do, and it just maybe you don't feel like it's making progress. You're just in a pouring stage. Now listen, I hope I wrote this down as one of your notes. Is you're going to be, there's no way out of it. You're going to be in a season where you're going to have to pour in on something that shows no progress. There's no doubt about it in your life, spiritually and otherwise, where, and God's going to call you to just pour. Just pour. I'm working on it. You can't see it on the surface, just like your grass, Richard. You don't see any grass yet, but I'm working. There's something happened under the surface that you can't see. So pour out anyway. Okay? Now, I learned this in ministry life. I stumbled into student ministry a long time ago, right? I wasn't the first choice or anything like that. I wasn't even trying to be a choice. But finally we did, and we stuck with it, me and my wife, and other people helped us, but grew a successful student ministry, and it was great, and I loved it, and I felt God was just pouring into me, and I felt like I was absorbing it well, most I've ever learned at one time. And I kept getting obstacles. I was connected to a church community. It just wasn't healthy. Okay. And I got to that point where I'm like, man, I'm trying the best I can. And I feel like, you know, is what I'm doing even matter? Okay. And despite the fruit that we saw, I thought, man, what is happening here? I had no idea, but we kept pouring and kept pouring. And I had no idea. And I'm glad that I kept pouring, because now I get to do this, okay, for the past 14 years, that if I wouldn't have continued to pour then, I wouldn't be able to do this now. Does that make sense? And I want to say the same thing's true for your life, man. You're going to be in a situation where you're not seeing the progress. You're not seeing it visibly, but God wants you to keep going, because when the Holy Spirit pushes you to pour, you just got to pour. You got to keep going, because maybe you didn't even understand what a pouring season was, what a watering season meant for you. But I'm telling you, it's a thing, and you'll be glad you did. And look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. It says, faith is being sure about what we hope for, being convinced about the things we do not see. So listen, God understands that visibly with our eyes, we might not see the progress. But when we have hope, man, and we're convinced about things that we do not see. So, and this is what that guarantees. There will be a season in your life that you see no progress and God keeps asking you to pour. Okay? So that's guaranteed. So what do you got to do? What's my season? What's my specific action? You just keep pouring. Keep doing it. Keep, you know, pouring integrity into the decisions you make. Keep pouring God's word into your children. Keep pouring God's word into your life and the right words into your marriage. Just keep pouring, okay? And one day you'll be happy you did. It actually propels you into the next season, because when you water now, you'll see the results in the next season. Am I making sense? Okay. So what's my season and what's my specific action? And some of you, man, right now it's pouring. I just got to water. I just got to keep doing it. That's the season I'm in. The next one's this. So after you're working and you're watering, then it's waiting. There's a waiting season. There's a season of just waiting, okay? And sometimes that's difficult, because you just don't put a seed in the ground and pour water on it and an apple pops up. That's just not how it happens, but there is a season, and remember, everything's done in seasons. We're learning that from God's word, and what you have to realize is this is, it's absolutely going to happen, and I want to show you that there's going to be a waiting period. I want to show you in Scripture here. 1 Corinthians 3 and 6 says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God caused it to grow. Okay, get this. I planted. It's saying somebody else helped me water it, but God is the one that caused it to grow. And let me make sure you get it. I started, I poured. There came a season that no matter what I do, it's ultimately going to be up to God to grow it. That is what that scripture is telling us, and we got to get this, because there's some season you can get started all day long. You can hustle and keep planting and all that stuff, but what I love about farmers is they don't try to change the seasons. We're like, God, come on, you know, change. Let's do a shift of the season I'm in. God, would you bring the next one on? Because I've had enough of this one, but a farmer doesn't do that. He just makes sure that his actions line up with the season he's in. I told you I'd beat you over the head with it now. And you know what you need to do when you're in a waiting season? Because you could be the best farmer in the world, have the best seed, you did the straightest rows, and live in the perfect climate for it. But ultimately, and most farmers would tell you, that God's got to take it from here. I've done everything that I'm supposed to do. And in that season, the appropriate action in that waiting season is to rest. Rest in knowing what God has promised for you, okay? Some of you are like, man, God, you know, I'm so worried about my kids. I want them to know the Lord so bad. Maybe it's your adult children. I want them to know God so bad. And if he, you know, if he's going to come through on it, all you can do is what you can do, right? You're faithful. You're reading scripture. You're doing all the faithful things. And I know some of you smart alecks might say, well, Richard, what is it? Is it working? Is it, you say start work, now you're saying rest. Which one is it? It's both. It's both. That's why you need to know what season you're in, because sometimes, man, faith is getting started, and sometimes faith is knowing, man, you've done all you can do, and you just got to let God do the rest. We need to be able to discern that. And if you don't know what season you're in, you can't make the right decision. Okay? We need to know that. And some of you are sitting, man, when you need to get started. Some of you are planting fields that's already got plenty of seed in it. So here's your choice when it's a waiting season. You can wear yourself out. Yeah, you can put more seed out, I guess. You can do all that, but or you can just rest, and knowing that God's going to fulfill his promises. There's just a waiting period for that. And I want to encourage you with something here. And this is that it's ultimately had nothing to do with the message. It's something I read this week. It was in Psalm 121, verse 4. I read it this week, and it says, the God of Israel never sleeps or slumbers. That is awesome. And here's what I decided, man. If he's going to never sleep or slumber, I'm going to go to sleep. I'm going to rest. He don't need my help. If he's not going to bed, I'll let him do the work, man. And while he works, I'll rest. That's kind of what it said to me in that moment. And it doesn't matter how much you try, how much more hustle that you have. Listen, ultimately, it's God that makes it grow. We got to understand that as believers, man. We'll drive ourselves crazy. So you might as well rest in what he's already promised you. Ecclesiastes 3 and 11 says, God does everything right and on time. That should really, once you kind of marinate in that a little bit, listen, God's not early. He's never late. He's right on time. But people can never completely understand what he's doing. You're not meant to understand. There's some things that are just not for us. Right? It takes away our opportunity to show faith if we knew everything he was doing. It wouldn't require any faith. But I love it that it says God does everything right and on time. And I know everybody in this room, man, you can't be in here not want to know God's plan for your life, man, but knowing that he has it. But there is a timetable to it. There's a timetable attached to what God has for you and your plan. And what I'm trying to tell you is that while you're waiting, it's not worthless. Your waiting is not worthless. I wish you'd write it down. When God's got you waiting, man, it's probably a really good indicator that He's working hard on something. Something great and grand. It really is. And when I was trying to read about things that you grow and, you know, how long things germinate for all the other part of the series we're going to be in, I learned, I don't know if you knew this, a mushroom can grow in 6 hours. 6 hours. That's pretty good. God can, I mean, I guess He could make it grow in 1 second, but just the growth of it, to expect a mushroom, 6 hours, that's pretty good. But you know how long it takes for a mature red oak? It takes 60 years. See what I'm saying? And see how much more greater that is? But it's a lot more waiting time, okay? And so I feel like that's what God is trying to say is, look, I've got something for you, but it takes time. You're wanting me to hurry when this type of thing is as big as I want to give you and as much as I want for you, it takes time. And it's going to require faith in the waiting for that, right? And so here's what I figure, man, just from what Scripture says. Sometimes we have this tendency, we're so impatient. It's the culture we live in. It's the nature of us to go against what, you know, God's flow of things are. But here's what I've deducted is that when we try to rush it along, God, I'm lonely, I need a mate, right? And I believe He would say, based on what Scripture is, I'm working on it. This is something very important. I want the best for you. I'm working on it. It's going to be great. And when you wait, you're going to be glad that you did, because it's awesome. But when we take the wheel, there should be a new country song, Jesus, give me back the wheel. When we take over, sorry about that. Scratch that from the... But when we take over, man, I believe Scripture is pretty clear on this. We shortchange ourselves. We're not going to experience everything that God had for us. When we force something to happen, there's a timetable attached to your waiting. And that should give us plenty of encouragement. With the mushroom and the red oak, all of that, is that God's working on something really big and really awesome. Listen, the whole point of this series starting out today was just kind of an appetizer for what's to come. I want to encourage you as you start to consider, man, who can I bring to this environment to hear God's word? And here's what they're going to hear. They're going to hear good news. I think that every time we meet, man, we ought to have good news, something we hear that is life-changing. And I believe they're going to come in and hear about Jesus. That they're going to hear that, He's the Son of God, but He gave His life on a cross to pay a debt. Not just any debt, but your sins and mine of all time, all humanity. And it required Him dying on the cross to pay that. And if we put our faith in Him, man, He doesn't just promise a place in heaven. He gives us an assignment on this planet. And we get to be a part of His kingdom here on earth, right? And He gives us the Holy Spirit, which convicts us. There is such a thing as sin and a real place called hell. But He came to save us from that, to rescue us from it. And man, when we get the Holy Spirit in us after we decide to follow Him, He gives us the power to overcome those things that have such a stronghold on your life. And I believe people are going to hear this message. They're going to be so glad that you invited them into this environment. I think very authentic people. Not perfect, for sure, right? We kind of stink. But we're on the same path. We want to discover what God's got planned for our life. And, man, God's going to speak to us through this lens of agriculture to help us to understand His word better. Because it might not come naturally, because we're not very agrarian, too much of an agrarian society, right? But we're learning. And so would you stand with me? Just kind of give yourself some privacy.